Welcome to Evacuation 101, tips for efficiently preparing systems for charging. We're glad you trust Yellow Jacket to provide you with the information you need to do your job more quickly and effectively. This is the second in a series of videos designed to help you work smarter and safer. In this video, we'll go over how to remove air and contaminants from an HVAC system, creating a vacuum state. It's important to note that a vacuum pump is not a recovery unit. A recovery unit should always be used to make sure the refrigerant is recovered from the system before you begin the vacuum process. A vacuum can help protect your system from contaminants and non-condensable gases, which can damage HVAC system components, reduce system efficiency, and even cause failure. A vacuum pump pulls air and contaminants out of the system after it has been repaired and before it is recharged. The deeper and more complete the vacuum, the more contaminants are removed. This example shows how a vacuum pump can remove the air from this bell jar and even begin removing the air and moisture trapped inside a marshmallow. Note how the marshmallow grows as the trapped air and moisture expand inside the marshmallow due to the low pressure around it created by the vacuum pump. It then begins to get smaller as some of the trapped air and moisture escape through the surface. When the vacuum is removed from the bell jar, you can see how much air and moisture have been removed from the marshmallow by its reduced size. A vacuum pump will have the same effect on a refrigeration system, removing air and moisture trapped in the system components and even in the compressor oil. A quality vacuum pump will consistently pull a deep vacuum of 50 microns or less. Some will even pull as low as 15 microns. To achieve the deepest vacuum, use a two-stage rotary vane oil-sealed pump, such as the Yellow Jacket Super Evac vacuum pump that we're using in this video. This video will present you with tools and methods to help you improve your evacuation skills and become more efficient on the job. All projects start with safety, and evacuation is no different. Always read and comply with all warnings and instructions found in the manufacturer's manual before operating any pump. When working with tools and machines like a vacuum pump, it's always wise to wear safety goggles. Some pumps come with an exhaust cap, which should be in place when your pump is not in use. If you forget to remove this cap, it's likely to pop off upon startup. So first, remove the cap, and second, simply keep your head clear of the pump when starting up, just to be safe. Never block the exhaust port. Make sure the area around it is free. Always use a grounded three-prong outlet and extension cord. Inspect electrical cords for damage before using them, and keep the cords dry throughout the process. Also, make sure that there is no positive charge in the system before you begin the vacuum process. Positive charge can damage the pump's vanes or valves. If you've used nitrogen to test for leaks, make sure it's completely removed from the system before beginning the vacuum process. Finally, if you're taking your pump to the roof, look for a pump with a sturdy lifting eye. The lifting eye offers a safe, secure means to connect a rope or chain hook for pump transport. Like any other job, having the right equipment can make all the difference. Let's take a few minutes to talk about some of the features that you should look for on your vacuum pump, and also some of the accessories that can improve the efficiency of the evacuation process. To reach the deepest vacuum in the shortest amount of time, use a two-stage rotary vane oil-sealed pump in place of a single-stage pump. One feature that you'll find useful is a large diameter oil fill port. It makes adding oil easy and minimizes the risk of making a mess. It's important to be able to gauge how full the pump is when adding oil, so make sure your pump has an easy-to-read sight glass. Another seemingly simple feature is the oil drain plug. Again, look for a large opening. This will allow for quick oil drainage, which means you get your jobs done faster. Some pumps also come equipped with a vacuum gauge indicator, which will give you a coarse view of the vacuum being pulled. This one has a green zone, which corresponds to about 100,000 microns. If your pump can't pull into the green zone, then it's likely that you still have a leak. Once you do pull into the green zone, you can begin relying on the more precise measurements of an electronic vacuum gauge. We'll talk more about this in a few minutes. Another feature to look for is an isolation valve, which allows you to shut off, drain oil, and refill the pump without losing a great deal of vacuum, saving a lot of time when an oil change becomes necessary in the middle of a job. Every pump has to exhaust. If it's not exhausting something, it's not working. Don't be alarmed if you see a fine oil mist. There may be instances when the exhaust can be an annoyance, such as when you're working in an indoor location like a machinery room, hospital, computer room, or restaurant. In those cases, you'll want to vent the exhaust outside. To do this, make sure your vacuum pump is equipped with an exhaust fitting sized for a standard garden hose attachment. Simply connect the garden hose to the exhaust fitting and discharge the exhaust outside of the room. Along with a reliable pump, there are a number of other tools that will help you be more efficient on the job. Let's start with hoses. First of all, always use the largest diameter hose that you can, even if your system has quarter-inch fittings. In this case, look for a 3/8 inch hose with 3/8 inch fittings to attach to your pump. Also, use the shortest hose possible to get maximum evacuation speed. Long hoses will slow the process. Unlike rubber hoses, corrugated stainless steel hoses have no permeation. If you keep these clean and maintain them well, they will offer the most effective evacuation possible, job after job. Every technician should have a pair of vacuum valve and core removal tools. This tool allows you to remove Schrader valves from the system and evacuate through unrestricted lines for a faster and higher vacuum, which can save you a minimum of 30% in time. Definitely a key tool for the job. If your system has both high and low side ports, use a vacuum valve and core removal tool for each port. And ask your wholesaler about similar tools for use with R410A systems and mini splits where the fittings may be different. Use of a manifold can decrease vacuum time by over 50%. The system shown includes a 4-valve vacuum manifold and 2 3/8-inch vacuum hoses. Remember, 3/8-inch hoses will evacuate faster than quarter-inch hoses. Finally, there's no way to know when you have pulled an adequate vacuum without an electronic vacuum gauge. ASHRAE recommends evacuation to below 1,000 microns, and after isolation, a system must not rise above 2,500 microns within several hours. 1,000 microns equals only 0.039 inches of mercury, a measurement that cannot be made with a mechanical gauge or determined by evacuation time or the sound of a pump. The only tool that can measure vacuum at these levels is an electronic vacuum gauge. With an electronic vacuum gauge, the technician can see the last evidence of moisture being removed and witness